Thank you. Hello, everyone. I will be very politically incorrect in this talk, so I will start by apologizing. So first of all, because I will give the talk in English. So I'm really sorry, I don't feel confident enough to speak in Spanish. So sorry for that. I really wish I could speak in Portuguese and most of you were going to understand me. So instead I will just speak in English. Second reason for apologizing for this talk is basically like the way that I am dressing. But we are in Cancun, I couldn't resist going and giving a talk dressing like this. Okay, so I really apologize for that. I really mean no disrespect. I just couldn't resist. So in this talk, the idea is to discuss challenges in the computer. I will try to explain like how your computer works, like why the computer is so complex, the different components we have in a computer. And I will try to explain why like governments and other entities are trying to rootkit your computer, what they're trying to do that, and what you can do to try to protect yourself. So I will start, of course, with some disclaimers. I am not speaking like for in the name of Intel, okay? Nobody from Intel revealed this talk. We have one good point on that. The good point is I could say whatever I wanted to say, and if you ask me questions, I could try to answer as honest as I can. The downside of that is maybe I will say something wrong and nobody revealed the talk, so it might have inconsistencies. I really, really tried my best to not make mistakes. So the second point is like I will be talking about an architecture that does not exist yet. So most of the points I will present are regarding like Skylake, which is gonna be released on 2015, 2016, but that's according to Wikipedia. I don't have the Intel official information on that, but I believe Wikipedia is correct. I'm not sure. I will try to be very generic. So everything that I say, even though it applies to Skylake platform, it probably applies to older versions of the platform, and I will also try to include terms in ARM and AMD and other like vendors and other architectures when I can. If you have questions, just ask them straight away, okay? Don't need to wait or anything. Let's try to be like very informal because the idea here is to really exchange information. So, important notice, I don't work for McAfee or what they call like Intel Security Group, okay? I work on a security team that does the security of the processor itself. It's nothing related to software products, AV, or anything related to that. And I don't know much about like these products of McAfee. So I will try to avoid answering questions regarding that. So I already anticipate people will ask about some specific components that have been like in the news in the past. So the first one is the random number generator. So the random number generator in the platform is a digital random number generator. What that means is basically it uses some physical elements to generate the first values of the entropy. And after that, it uses like computer algorithms to extend that and to provide more randomness. So if you ask me, is that strong enough? I will ask you back. It depends. What is your enemy? What is the kind of risk you're trying to avoid? Okay, it's probably much stronger than if you just do everything in software. Probably it's not as strong as if you do everything using physical elements with a dedicated hardware, okay? There is rootkits on that or not? Well, I look it into like the HGL of that, and I could say there is none, but of course, I am not a mathematician, so maybe I missed something, but I expect not. I will talk a little bit more about like rootkits on the platform later. The other question that probably people will ask me is about AMT, which is like a technology that runs in, on top of ME, which is the manageability engine. I will not be commenting on that because the guys from Germany, like from the Insinuator blog, they're already doing some research on that. So I will just point instead to their blog, and I hope like people follow what they're doing. It's like very interesting point to research. So I will start asking like a few questions. But before that, I will explain the difference between what is the architecture and what is the microarchitecture. So basically, architecture are like the parts of your computer that really interact with you, that really makes difference to you. When I say to you, I am talking to you as if you were a binary running on your computer or if you were like an assembler level developer, okay? If you're really communicating straight to the hardware. Microarchitecture, in the other side, is basically everything in the architecture that we can change and there will be no difference for the end user. So basically, everything that we change on the microarchitecture, like trying to optimize the results that the architecture gives to you. The only element that we consider microarchitecture, but actually the user feels the difference, are related to timing. But that's the only exception, okay, to that rule. So one example of things that are part of the architecture are like, for example, what is the wide of your registers? What is the address methods that you have, addressing methods that you have? What is the instruction set that you have in your computer? Those are like part of the architecture. So as you guys know, like we try to keep the architecture like as compatible as possible. The microarchitecture on the other side, that changes a lot. Okay, so sometimes when you see like two different generations of the computer and you believe, hey, almost nothing were changed, sometimes it was like completely changed the microarchitecture of it. So that's why we see the performance increments, we see like some new features getting in. So like Intel always tries to change the microarchitecture instead of trying to change the architecture itself. So your computer nowadays looks like basically like this graph. So most people here will remember when we had like the South Bridge and we had like a North Bridge. That does not exist anymore. So your core, like as you see there, core, is like what we call core, and we have what we call uncore, which is this whole package which has like the memory controller, the caches, the core itself, a graphics communication agent, and we have like the system agent for communication with high performance. So this is what we call uncore. So the difference, like for most of us, is known, right? On the security perspective, and though, the difference is huge. Basically, like now we have like much more elements in the core. So we have like a much bigger package. We have much more complexity, which means more features and benefits if you want to protect, but also more points for attacking if you are an attacker. And everything, of course, needs to be like security validated. So the architecture, your computer looks really like this. You have like different elements and different compositions and different things talking to other things, right? Each bus has what we could call a protocol, which is like the way that the communication happens on that bus. So every time you see a line there, imagine this is basically like a connection, like in a network. So imagine that your computer is basically a network per se. It has different chips, different elements communicating to each other, and we need to guarantee they are securely communicating, right? Good. So, above the computer complexity, who here ever heard about IO MMIU? Known? Some of you. Cool. So, Intel VTD or IO MMIU was a technology that was introduced basically to protect like virtualized environments. And the idea is like to have a memory management unit protecting IO or DMA from your devices. So the idea is like you can isolate devices in different virtualized views of the memory. So you don't have like a compromised device basically accessing everything in the memory that was in use by another device or by another component of the architecture. So I see like many papers about like IO MMIU. Many people talk about that. Some people talked about using IO MMIU, for example, to bypass forensics analysis. So that's an interesting research by Joanna. But I have a question. How many IO MMIU components you think there are in your computer? 1, 2, 0? That's the kind of questions that nobody knows, right? We see people talking, and when we read the articles, like, apparently people go really deep on the architecture, they really explain a lot of things on the architecture, but when you look into the drawing, right? If I come back here and I look into this drawing, if there is something protecting like the PCI Express devices here from communicating with the memory there, how that same thing is protecting the graphic cards that is on top there to communicate with the same memory? It's just impossible, right? So it must be either two things, or there is like a router in the middle that is doing this routing, which will affect performance. So we can assume safely it's at least two, one for your graphics cards and the other one for all your other devices. And what happens when you have like two different components implementing security? What is the problem with that? Do they have the same policy? Do they protect using the same principles of your security? this kind of complexity that we see in networks, and I am sure you guys know much more than I do about this complexity in networks, you have the same level of complexity inside your own PC. When you implement like protection mechanisms in software that use those harder protections, you need to have an understanding of that. And the biggest problem that I see nowadays on the industry is like people are talking about forensics, people are talking about incident handling, but they don't even understand their own computers. And that's really a big problem, because those features, those kind of lack of problems or lack of configurations or like mistakes in the configuration generate problems. And that's what the governments are abusing and the rootkits they are creating use. And I will talk a little bit more about that later. So another question, is the IOM MIU a chip, a real hardware, or is that software? Give a guess. It's a chip, okay? Actually, all the memory lookup we have in the platform is basically implemented by hardware, it's not software. Good. Where it's located, I already mentioned, you have at least two, one between your PCI device and the other one between like your graphics card. So that was easy. Everyone knew the answer, right? So how many processors you have in your machine? That's a better one. Two, four. Two processors with four threads. What is the answer? Anybody wants to guess? No? Nobody is following? Nobody cares? So, I care. So, of course, you have your CPUs and the threads that you have in the CPU, right? Everybody knows that. Everybody counts that, and that's in your specification when you buy your processor, right? But have anyone heard about the ME that I just mentioned? So, everybody heard about? So, ME is Manageability Engine. And that's per se really forces me to make a detour and explain you about this ME chip. So the interesting thing about this chip is basically it runs Java on it. It has its own real-time operating system running. And the processor is an ARC processor, which is RISC. It's not even x86. The ME is in all client machines, which means it's in all machines you guys buy. Even if you turn your machine off, the ME is on. And it has capabilities of talking to the network. That's through the ME that, for example, some outsourced or third-party vendors implement the Find My Computer stuff, right? When someone steals your laptop and they plug your laptop somewhere in the network, like it communicates to the network and tells where the laptop is, which is very common in cell phones. You also have that for PCs. That's running in ME. It's Java code. It runs in your machine. It runs like third-party code. That is, of course, it's signed code, but it's still, it's not even developed by Intel itself. So this is the complex that you have nowadays in your computer. And like we like care about security, we care about networks, and most people don't even know that it's there. It's big, huge, major concern. Still talking about the processors you have in your architecture. Who here heard about PCU or Power Control Unit? Anyone? Some of you? None of you? So the Power Control Unit is really cool. It runs a pure assembly written OS operating system. The assembly, like the ISA for this processor, is very similar to x86, but it's not x86. It's basically a subset of it. It basically runs watchdogs that take care of the voltage of your computer to make sure your computer, for example, if your processor is executing something and it's using too much energy, it guarantees that your system doesn't hang. Okay? So the PCU is responsible for basically power control in your platform. It's another operating system, it's another processor, and it's in your computer, in all your computers. It runs an architecture that is called Harvard architecture. So it tries to isolate run and run. So basically, where you have data, you were not supposed to execute code. And of course, even though like the manuals say it's a Harvard architecture, the manuals also mention there is an update mechanism for it. If you can update the firmware, which means you can load a patch and execute from memory that patch, it's not really a complete Harvard architecture, which means it also lets you execute code in data areas. So this is your PCU. But there is more. There is the PMC, or the power management controller. Who here heard about that one? So what is that? This is the PCH PCU. As you guys remember, the PCH is basically the soft bridge. So everything that is not your processor, right? Everything that is like the motherboard, basically. The components connecting to your motherboard, they connect to the PCH. And they also have their own PMC. And basically, this runs another operating system, another bunch of code, also supporting updates. That's another element, another processor in your computer. Just so you guys have an idea, how many operating systems we already talking about here? So you have your main one, you have the ME one, the PCU one, the PMC one. So in any system, doesn't matter if you're using virtualization or not, you have at least four different proposed processors running four different operating systems. Any machine. Good. You have also the graphics PCU, which is a different one, specifically for your graphics card and your graphics needs. And of course, you have your gigabit card. The gigabit is much simpler, but I really wanted to mention specifically the gigabit card, because that one has research on it, on how you can rootkit your gigabit card and basically upload like a malicious payload on it. So the idea of this research is basically like he demonstrated that he could load a malicious firmware in your gigabit card, and when it receives a specific packet, it sends to the PCI bridge that the gigabit card is connected to another part of the rootkit. So basically he managed to have like remote access control over your entire machine using a rootkit that it's only running on your gigabit card. That means doesn't matter which tools you run on your Windows box, Linux box, FreeBSD box, doesn't matter what is the operating system you have there and which tools you run there. If you don't dump the firmware of your gigabit card, you just don't see that rootkit. It's running purely in firmware. Good. We have more. We have the validation control unit, which is basically used for validation, but it's also there. We have BMC in servers, and there is also research published on that. The BMC is basically like the ME for servers. The BMC connects through an interface called IPMI that gives complete control over everything in your machine. And in servers, that comes like with web browser, with like web server, gives you like completely control for updating your machine to get status of your machine. And like the guys from Rapid7, they released like some exploits on Supermicro BMC servers. And they basically, like, I don't know if you guys saw that paper, but like I put the link in the presentation. But basically, the vulnerabilities were like you had like username and password, and you had a stack, a basic classical Stack Overflow in the username field of the CGI form. It's like one of the stupidest and easiest to exploit vulnerabilities ever. Okay? And it was affecting a vendor, a main vendor. Okay? And it's there. If you install the server, you put it in your network, it's connected to the internet, and it's vulnerable. Good. So that was tricky, right? I asked questions about like some specific components. It was like not many people know about them. Some of them already had research published, so it's important that we are aware. Even more if we're talking about like if you care about like state nations attacking you, or if you care about protecting some infrastructure that is really critical, you need to be aware of those at least. But that was tricky, I agree. So let's go for something easier. Okay? What is the execution modes your processor has? So, I will start, okay? I will say real mode, virtual 886 mode, protected mode, which is where most of operating systems runs with, and SMM or system management mode, right? By the way, like 6 years ago, I published like a research on system management mode where like I basically managed to load an entire code in the system management mode and run a rootkit from there. So the operating system, even your operating system, couldn't touch the rootkit. The memory of the rootkit was protected by the architecture itself. Since then, Intel fixed the bugs, okay? Now it's not so easy to load code there. But, of course, hackers are always attacking, right? So in the POC GTFO, which is like an underground zine, it's available for anyone to download, it's free. The license only says that if you download, you need to redistribute it to someone. So if you want to read, first find someone who didn't read that, and then you read it and send to him. But basically, in this magazine, the guys published an entire debugger running on this specific mode of execution of your processor. So lots of people are doing research on the architecture, and there is knowledge, okay? And the knowledge is public. But lots of people working on the fence just don't know about them. Continue about the modes, right? Since I started, I will go to some other modes. So X64 guys, everyone who understands about 64 bits architecture, they know there is like a 32E mode, which is basically for you to run 32 bits programs in 64 bit mode. You have the 64 bit mode itself. But they are not real modes, right? I'm like just like showing you guys that your processor runs in different states and different situations. So you have more, much more, many more actually. So you have VTX. What is the VTX? Who remembers that? It's the virtualization extensions. So anyone who is running like the virtualization extensions, or like for example, running VMware, for instance, in like a modern computer, will have like the VTX mode on. You have the SGX. Who here heard about the SGX? Or software guard extensions? The software guard extensions is something that's completely new. The idea is like to have a protected mode of operation for your applications. So there's like lots of good usage for defensive, but of course there will be use for like attacking as well. So it's important that people working on defense knows about those modes. I will talk a little bit more about SGX later. But of course, I'm just like playing around, right? There is like so much to know, and nobody knows everything. Believe me, it's just impossible. Like every time I start looking into the computer, and as more as I dig deeper into the computer, I discover something completely new and that I had no idea about before. And that's why it's hard, right? It's difficult to defend, because the attackers, if they find one new way to hide their code in your computer, they win. Right? They will hide the code, you will not find the code until someone in the defense decides to find the same technique and publish, and then the software some years later get updated to start looking to that specific component. So defense always take longer to find this stuff, right? It's difficult to defend, I know that. There is other modes, and those modes were supposed to be known by everyone, but they are not. So who here heard about CRAN mode? Known, right? CRAN, or CRAN basically means cache as run. There is another mode called CAR, which also means cache as run, but it's completely different kind of cache as run. So, of course, we love like big corporations because they create like the same acronyms for completely different things, right? That's what they do. So, CAR, or cache as run, is basically when you boot in your machine has no memory. Right? The BIOS needs to initialize memory. But BIOS itself is a code that needs to run and needs to call functions and needs to do like specific tasks on the computer. So the way for like a BIOS implement and use stack is implemented through the cache of your machine. So the cache is used as run, that's why CAR. CRAN mode on the other side is a more protected mode of execution, which leads me to what we call TXT. Who here heard about the TXT? So, TXT was released many years ago. And the idea of the TXT basically to provide attestation in your platform. And that's where I really wanted to be in this talk. Everything that I mentioned in this talk is basically to get to this point. The point is, the architecture is complex. It's very difficult. You have lots of challenges, right? How do you defend them? So, TXT. Basically, TXT is there for many years, but nobody's using. That's why they need to talk about it. TXT uses the cache as run, but in the case is CRAN, for running a code that is signed, and it's called ACM. The ACM is basically a trusted code that will check your computer status. So when you run like TXT, the idea is like you can collect information about your hardware. Like for example, you can like measure your initialization routines of the hardware. You can measure the VMM of your hardware. The idea is like your machine is basically creating an attestation and signing that attestation for you. If you send this data out of your machine, you can basically verify if that the machine changed, for example, in the last month, or if it changed against like what it was supposed to be the factory defaults. And that's why TXT is important. I will get back to TXT in a minute. But just to finish talking about modes, we have another mode of execution that not many people know, which is called the probe mode. The probe mode is basically a debugging mode, and it's available to anyone. So depending on the level of access you have more or less features in probe mode, but it's available to anyone. So for example, Intel employees, we have a way to unlock the computer that we have more access in probe mode. BIOS vendors, they have another key that unlocks other features for them. And of course, the users, end users, will have the standard features of probe mode. But the matter is, like, it's also there. It's also another mode of execution of your processor, and there's like lots of capabilities on that mode as well that not many people are aware of. So, like 6 years ago, this was the drawing about like mode of executions in your machine. So imagine this is your processor, it's running, when it's booting it's like a real address mode, then it goes to protected mode, you have like system management entrance when you have an SMI. The computer was that. That was like very simplified view of the computer. Of course, nowadays it's much more difficult to define this drawing. Okay, you see like the lines start like overriding other lines. It's much more complex, it's much more difficult to have an understanding of what is going on. That's why we need to have attestation, and that's why we are here, right? We want to protect that. So, to me, one thing is very clear. I don't know if you guys ever heard about the 6 stages of debugging software or hardware. The first stage is like, no, that can't happen. There is no bug there. That's the very first stage. When you start evolving and digging into the problem, you get into the last stage that you're basically asking, hey, how that ever worked, right? It's so complex that it's unbelievable how that actually works, okay? If you think about, lots of your computer is actually software. If you look into like the lowest level of interface that you have with your computer, like assembly, every instruction you have in your ISA is basically translated to what we call a micro instruction. And like actually the translation is not one to one. In average, we have like for every instruction, we have 1.1 micro instructions, which basically, roughly speaking, means your computer is more software than hardware. Okay, that's super interesting to start considering that. And that's why, like, if you were like a guy in software, you can really delve super deep in your computer, even though you are not a hardware guy. You don't like to kick things, you just like to screw them, right? Good. So, the question again, what about the backdoors? I promised I was going to comment about backdoors, right? So, I also heard a response from someone in Intel, but I don't remember who was the guy, so I am not like putting his name here, but if any of you knows who is the guy, please let me know, because I really want to give him the credits for this perfect answer. So the answer is basically like this. I am not aware of any backdoors, but if you ask me next year in the next LexSec, and I tell you I don't know or I don't want to comment, you take your own conclusions, okay? So. Honestly, of course, this is a joke, right? There is no backdoors just because there is no need for backdoors. It's complex per se. If something is that complex, this is the feeling that you need to have in security. Remember, like security and safety are basically what you believe, right? We believe we are secured right now, but we don't know if the CIA has a drone pointing a missile here right now, or if like a meteor is coming down here right now. That's the same with your computer. We feel safe because sometimes we just don't understand the risks or we don't see them. And that's the biggest problem that I have in the industry, with the security industry, is people are talking about products to block stuff. What about the attackers that are already inside? Do you see them? Are you sure? Are we really using the things that are there, that are available, that are free? Or not? Or are we just like looking to the next product to buy and we are forgetting what is free and is already part of your computer, like TXT, for example? So, when we look into like an attack or an attacker, the first thing that you need to define is like, what is the risk? Who you are fighting against, right? So that's what we call the TCB, or the Trusted Computing Base. So you need to define what you trust and what you don't. So I see lots of people arguing, like, yeah, there is a rootkit on a vendor X or Z. If there is a rootkit in your processor, there is a way for you to fight that? What do you guys think? There is not much that we can do if there were a rootkit there, right? But there is a need for putting a rootkit, because imagine, if it's at some point someone discovers there is a rootkit in like a main vendor like this, like for example in an Intel processor, that's game over to an entire industry, right? It's going to create a huge problem to everyone, even like American companies, because then foreigners will also be able to exploit that. So that's like a huge problem. So why they need to rootkit the processor itself, which is complex, which has lots of people looking after, when they can just rootkit parts of the process? Like, for example, the BIOS. The BIOS is chipped by different vendors, many different vendors. It's very hard to validate, and not many people are looking there. Also, like, your hardware has so many update mechanisms. All of them are being locked by your BIOS. Are you sure? Who is verifying that? Who is checking? Who is publishing research on that side, on that sense? Not many people, right? So, also, if the computer is so complex, why we have so small number of vulnerabilities? Why? Anybody has a guess? You want to say, wow, you guys in Intel are the best ones ever, you find all the bugs? I don't think so. Really, we don't. That's for sure, we don't. We do have a much higher level of access to the information than the attacker. So for sure, we find lots of the bugs. But I'm quite sure we're missing some. So who are the ones exploiting those bugs that we're missing? Who is doing that kind of research? Why we don't see papers out there? It's because no one is doing it, or because just nobody's talking about that? So, what do you want to improve in your network? What you can do immediately, now, right now, in all your computers? You can at least use the features that you have there to attestate, to actually see the status that you have, and then maybe look and try to compare with the vendor data. What is the problem here? The problem is like the vendors, like the motherboard vendors, the BIOS vendors, even like the VMware vendors, like virtualization vendors, so like virtual PC, VMware, other vendors, they're not publishing the attestation data of their products. So they are making it possible for someone to rootkit your products in the middle, right, in the supply chain. You're receiving your machine, it comes with a rootkit. You're downloading something, it comes with a rootkit. You don't know. Right? And you can get the attestation of your machine, but how you compare that? You compare against what? You don't have something to compare. So Intel has a product, which I don't know if they sell or not, called Mount Wilson. Mount Wilson, the idea is like basically, it's to centralize the attestation of all your machines. So it will use the TXT features to collect the status of all your machines in the network. I don't know if Mount Wilson is paid or not. I honestly don't know. But I know there is an open source version also developed by Intel. So even if Mount Wilson is paid and you don't care about that, just go for the open attestation, which is open source. This tool will actually permit you to go into a network, collect the information about all your machines, and at least have that data. What you can do with that data? Right now, not much, right? The first thing is, maybe in a month, you collect again and you see if it's changed. If it's changed, either you updated your BIOS, which is not that common, or someone updated it for you, which is probably very common right now, right? When I say someone updated for you, it was not with good intentions, probably. So, a suggestion for a project, and here we have so many certs, so I really, really expect one of the certs get into this project and do it. Start a project exchanging attestation information between different companies in different parts of the globe. Imagine how interesting it is if we get the attestation of all Dell machines, for example, in Brazil, or for part of Brazil, and then a part in Argentina, a part in Mexico, a part in Colombia, and then we compare that, and they are different. Whoa, that's interesting. Then we start catching the supply chain changes. We start catching those rootkits that people say they exist, but we are not sure if they really do or not, right? I see lots of people talking about lots of magic things. So let's start measuring and exchanging that information. The measurement is basically a hash, a computed hash of your machine. There is no confidential information, no reasons for not sharing it. So I really hope one of the certs, maybe the one in Brazil, will start like this project of exchanging information and exchanging this kind of information of attestation. And that's interesting because the TXT will even like getting attestation of VMMs. So your virtual memory manager, it will also get information about that. So that's cool. We already have one action, right? We can always start exchanging information and releasing things about like this malicious rootkits or whatever like BIOS vendors are putting. By the way, I don't know if everyone saw, but in December, 60 Minutes, which is I think a television program in the US, released like a saying that the NSA managed to get like rootkits coming from China. China had a plot to rootkit the BIOSes of all the machines in the United States of America. And you know, like, I don't know if this is bullshit or not, but I really want to see the attestation of everyone and start getting my own conclusions instead of believing on the media, right? So, and what about the future? What the computer is doing to try to help us in the future, right? Because like we have a very difficult fight to fight. Of course, the first thing is, for new features to actually be inserted in your processor, in your machine, we need to start using the old ones, right? If people are not using, what's going to happen? Like, the company will stop supporting them, right? With time, maybe, instead of having new features, we're going to have less. So I hope people start using that. But there is, like, cool stuff coming up, okay? So in Skylake, we're going to have some new technology. So one of them is, like, pointer lookout. The idea of pointer lookout is the processor will let you define where buffers in your memory start and end. And the processor will impose the limits. So nobody will be able to write after out of your buffer or reading from out of your buffer when it was supposed to read from that buffer. So that's super cool. So that will be like imposed by the processor. If you want to play with pointer lookout, if you want to be ahead of the peers because the machine does not exist, Intel already released the simulator. You can just download the simulator. It's free. You can install it in a Linux box. The GCC compiler already have the patches to compile your code automatically with point lookout. And then you can test. It's free. It's there. We just need like security guys to start looking into that and start playing with that. But this is one of the things that will come up in Skylake. And the other one is what we call SGX. So who here heard about the announcement even of SGX? Anyone? No? Yeah, honestly, I believe everyone here heard about the Intel Inside, right? Intel Inside, everybody heard about that. Everybody knows the music of Intel, right, in the marketing. But Intel is not really good on the technical marketing, I believe. So SGX, or Software Guard Extensions, or secure enclaves, if you will, is basically a new capability that's also coming up on the new processors of Intel that will permit you to have like software that is protected from the operating system. So how is that possible? So nowadays, you know, like an application, when it needs something, it needs to ask the operating system. The operating system, of course, gives or not access to something, and blah, blah, blah. One application is protected against the other. The architecture guarantees that to you, right? That's the protected mode of execution that we have nowadays. Everybody knows that. But also, everybody knows that if your operating system gets compromised, then that's game over. Right? Everyone knows that. It's game over. The operating system can do everything. There is no way to protect against the operating system. That's the current state when we have like the current machines, right? The idea of SGX is to provide a way to isolate a memory space in an application or a specific part of an application, to be more precise. And that memory area will be encrypted by a chip that is in the Uncore. So basically, this chip is directly communicating between the processor and the memory. So everything that goes to the memory will be encrypted. If a hardware tries to access that memory area, if someone taps into that memory area, if you do something on the bus, everything is encrypted. You don't see the data. The processor, of course, will see the decrypted data. So that's super interesting. That actually solves some of the problems that the industry had in the past. But most importantly, the operating system is seen as a malicious component. So the operating system will have no way to say that he wants to see the contents of a specific memory area. The idea of that is basically the OS still can say, yes, this application will run or not. So for example, if the OS decides the application will not run, the application will not run. The OS still defines if the application can access other memory areas out of the enclave. The OS still defines that. But the OS cannot interfere on the execution of the application inside the enclave. So that's, of course, super cool for DRM, which is not cool for us. I mean, for some of you, probably DRM is cool. For me, it's not. But it's super cool for other purposes as well. Like, for example, guaranteeing banking. So you have like a banking application. So the secure plugin of your bank might run in an enclave. It communicates security through the internet, and it can't be interfered with or tampered by a malware. So that's super cool. So the idea of that is basically like you have your usual process, your usual program, and a part of your program is running in the secured enclave. Intel is already communicating, of course, with like main compilers. So basically like this will be like transparent to the programmer. The programmer just needs to define, yeah, this is the code part that needs to be protected. He don't need to do anything special other than that. Okay, so that's cool about that. So right now, when you look into the attack surface of any application, you have the application itself, the entire application, because applications are bloated. If you look into, like, for example, your browser is probably bigger than the kernel of the operating system you run it. Okay, so your browser is huge. So you have your application, you have the operating system, you have your virtual memory manager if you're running virtualized, and you have a part of the hardware. Everything needs to be trusted. That's the current model. With SGX, basically what you're going to have is a part of your application will need to be trusted, or parts of your application, and a piece of the hardware, not the entire hardware. So that's the idea, limiting the amount of code that is exposed. Without using virtualization, of course. The MEE is a new chip that will be part of the Skylake, which is like the memory encryption engine. And by the way, everything that I'm talking here is kind of public, okay? I'm just better explaining it, but they are like kind of public already, just to make sure no one from AMD is taking notes to say, oh, I couldn't say AMD, right? It was politically incorrect, as I promised in the beginning. So the MEE basically is the chip that guarantees that all memory access are encrypted, which means like if the processor itself, like everything that is running on the core, of course we'll see the decrypted data, but everything that is running out of the perimeter of the core, we will only see encrypted data. That's transparent for the system, okay? So basically the MEE don't have like interactions, don't have configurations, the operating system don't have any options on dealing with the MEE. It don't set up MEE, it don't do anything with MEE. It's just there. If it's activated by the BIOS, it will be present in your system, and then enclaves start using it. Cool. So, as I mentioned, there is also BIOS. I already mentioned about the 60 Minutes in December, where like they mentioned about like this Chinese attack against America. I think they do that like to avoid us to look into the NSA. Anyway, I'm from Brazil. I don't like both sides attacking my country, and I guess nobody likes your country being attacked. Doesn't matter who is doing that or why. What matters is like BIOS is very complex. It's actually bloated. It's huge. It's impressive. It's wow, it's bigger than operating system for sure. And it's just growing and growing. And there is like lots of things that are OEM or vendor specific. So it's very hard for us to keep track of the BIOS. So it's another action that we have here then is, have you guys ever heard about ChipSec? No. So ChipSec is an open source tool that Intel just released like a past month in CanSec West. And it's open source, it's available for free, right? Open source for free even. Anyone can download and run against your systems. And basically what ChipSec does is it will check if your BIOS vendor is actually doing what it was supposed to do. So for example, do you guys remember when I mentioned the gigabit Ethernet has an update mechanism, right? Someone needs to activate a lock that avoids attackers to update your gigabit Ethernet card. So that someone is the BIOS. Do you guys remember when I said that the PCU had an update mechanism, right? Someone needs to activate a lock to avoid that, and that someone is the BIOS. SMM, the system management mode, to avoid someone to put some code to run there. Someone needs to lock that mechanism. That someone is BIOS. Actually, it's lots of things that BIOS needs to do. That's why it's so complex, right? So ChipSec basically will give you a checkup to tell you how your machine is. It's open source, it's free. If you never run that in your machine, I suggest you go immediately and do it. Okay? And if there is lots of things that are unlocked in your machine and you had a malware problem, I'd suggest you to start reviewing your BIOS again, because maybe you already have something malicious in your hardware and you don't even know. Good. So more things, more complexities, more funny things to look at. It's actually huge, right? I think I made that point very clear. But Intel also have like what we call architecture modifications or ISA extensions. So like, for example, the inception of new instruction set. So for example, ASNI. So it's instructions specifically for computing AES. They actually permit you to compute AES much faster than using like normal like software, like normal code for computing AES. It's much faster. Of course, that one is very easy to validate. There is no rootkits. You just need to do traditional AES, AES with those instructions and compare the result, because that's easy, symmetric cipher. But what's super cool, actually, it's not the new instructions and how like it's making life easier. It's because when they inject the new instructions, they don't want your program that uses the new instruction to fail in old hardware, right? Everyone wants compatibility. Right, so we want you to get your program that use AES instructions and then run in old hardware and then do nothing, like your program doesn't fail. It's super cool because then we can find NOPs, or instructions that do nothing in the architecture. So this is like a 10 bytes NOP for you guys who love like weird things about your computer. So a NOP is basically an instruction that do nothing, okay? The standard one is the X90, which is basically 1 byte. This one is like 10 bytes long. If you execute that in your processor, it will do nothing, basically, the same. Super cool, but it's bullshit, right? So, concluding. Guys, it's a challenge. Defense is a challenge. I know you all have lots of responsibilities, and it's super difficult to keep track of like what is going on and what is new and what is being released. But the matter is, if we don't create a pressure on the BIOS vendors, for example, to fix their stuff, or in your forensics providers to support and count on the fact that new and advanced techniques that abuse hardware components exist, and if we don't create that pressure, the most interesting, like the most advanced attacks, we are not even going to see. If people are doing that or not, I see lots of people like fighting, NSA saying like Chinese is attacking everyone, China saying NSA is attacking everyone, Brazilian president saying NSA reads their emails, like lots of things going on, right? We don't need to care, we need to protect. And there are tools there for us to protect, but we need to use them. And I really expect you guys to start using it. And if we start exchanging at least the attestation information, and when we see something don't match, we start blaming and coming up with the right questions, things will be forced to change. If we don't do that, really, don't care about random number or other rootkits, because you already lost the fight. Thank you very much. Bueno.
No sé si alguno tiene alguna pregunta, puede acercarse a los micrófonos. Mi pregunta para Rodrigo, tengo una, es, vos mencionaste, te puedo preguntar en español, ¿verdad? Mencionaste que una de las opciones que había, por ejemplo, era el tema de attestation, ¿ok? La pregunta era si sabías si había algún esfuerzo en ese área, y si no oíste ninguno, ¿cuál crees que es el motivo por el cual eso no se llevó adelante todavía?
Yeah, well, basically, like TXT is a standard that was released like many years ago. Intel even published a book that is free for download about TXT, and like there is an attestation group. It used TPM, it's based on TPM, and I guess you guys know that TPM, the chip, has like two versions. Like the version 2 supports like what we call software TPM, so there is no problems like in the past where you need to trust a hardware vendor, like for example, all the TPM hardware vendors were from China. So that does not exist on the modern TPM. The matter is like, people don't know. I think there is like a lack of marketing campaign to actually promote that in the right circles. Like for example, I don't think someone came here and talked like to the certs before to explain those things and to explain like this is a possibility. I think also there is a lack of understanding on the limitations. It's complex. TXT is complex. Now you have open source tools to manage that, and I think like this is also a part of the understanding that Intel had that people were not using because it was complex. Now we don't have that excuse. It's basically easy. You just need to run the tools. So I think it was more like misinformation, really.
Y que hay, por ejemplo, en ese mismo sentido de países. Digo, más de una vez uno escucha, por ejemplo, desde algunos países en particular, como que hay problemas en fabricar hardware de países como China u otros lugares. ¿Por qué crees vos que en el caso de esos países, por ahí se hace una campaña más de decir no fabriquemos chips o tecnología en determinado lugar, en vez de implementar, por ejemplo, medidas como las que vos mencionaste? O sea, ¿por qué no ocurre eso? No hablo por ahí de la comunidad en general, sino de hasta de esfuerzos por parte de países.
It's just like a big campaign, right? Like it's easier to just say, yeah, China is doing something wrong and point the finger, then go and fix the problem, right? Measure things are not easy. You need to exchange measurement information and you need to have an understanding, right? Because for example, maybe our measurements don't match, not because of a rootkit, but because of an update that I don't have and you do, or because I have a different component on my architecture. So that demands understanding. What I see is like the governments don't really understand. The part of, the offensive parts of the government, they do understand pretty well, right? We can see that the NSA does have BIOS hijacking capabilities. We know the Chinese also do have BIOS hijacking capabilities. I hope the Brazilians also, I am not sure. But the matter is, like, the offensive side doesn't care about defense, right? They care about offense. And the guys doing defense, they have so many other things to care about, right? I saw like in this conference, for example, I saw so many other problems people were discussing, and they are like super important as well. So it's difficult to stop and pay attention to the basics, to what your computer is actually doing. Usually we are so used to say, yeah, the computer is working, so there is nothing wrong, or the only problem is the operating system, that sometimes we forget about what is behind the hood.
Bueno, si no hay ninguna pregunta adicional, pido entonces un aplauso para Rodrigo.